new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
I'm holy. You are holy.
Clothed in rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Yeah. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
You are holy. You are holy.
Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder, at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath of living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come.
Welcome to church, everybody. Sorry, I'm all over the place, a little here, there, everywhere. Just excited that we could come together today. Going to honor some seniors today here in a few minutes. Going to have Trish and her girls come up here, actually before I do the graduates, but not yet, because we're waiting on some graduates to get here. So just excited that we can come together this morning. Have a few announcements before we get going. Today, the youth are putting on a fundraiser, so if you want to stay and eat some food, if you may have already had a donut or some fruit and stuff like that. But there's going to be pulled pork and baked beans and chips and watermelon. I don't like watermelon. Lachelle's like, you're not, doesn't matter if you don't like it, other people do. So there's watermelon. all sorts of good stuff. So if you want to stick around and have some food and bless the youth, I know they'll greatly appreciate it. So that's coming. We're excited for that. 42 people signed up to go to Peru this summer, which is crazy, amazing, and awesome. So excited for that. There is lots of things that are coming. We are excited about our youth camp, which actually starts next Sunday. It's a completely free camp for your youth, your young people. Just challenge you to sign up your kids. If you know of anyone that's doing nothing, it'll be an amazing week. So excited for that. Talk to me. I'd love to chat with you about it. It's a really, really cool, exciting thing. I'll show you guys a video next week, but we got this massive foam machine. So it's pretty incredible. It'll cover you up in foam real fast. So excited for that. Just lots and lots of good things coming. There is tomorrow night, no men's Bible study at Pastor Mark's house. There are some single moms events coming up. Single moms pizza with Pastor Mark and Rachel, friend here at the church, June 1st, 6:30 p.m., as well as June 16th, 1 p.m. Supermoms cookout here at the church at 1 p.m. With Peru coming up, we have a prayer night for the Peru team Sunday, June 10th at 7 p.m., as well as Saturday, June 16th, 9 a.m. to noon, we have the Peru team skit training here at the church. So all those things are coming. We're excited about it. God is moving. So we're looking forward to all that's coming. Trish, if you and your girls want to come up here now, still waiting on some seniors to get here, and I'll turn the microphone. Okay, yeah, they're coming. So I'm not going to dance, but don't tell me, come on, Cole, my son's down here. no way. Just excited. I guess as I stand here and talk, see God moving. And I was just for camp, I was getting ready to buy some sand for some of the stuff that we have going on, and God just put on my heart to talk to somebody, and sure enough, that person is getting the sand for free for us. So what an amazing thing that God is going to do. Here comes the Blankens. So you can come up here so the balcony can see you, ladies. So here you ladies go.
I'll take it.
Mark will take it.
Yeah, I think I got it right here.
Okay.
All right. Lot to do today. We have graduates, a bunch of graduates graduating this week, 11 graduates in our church, high school graduates in our church, but we don't want to miss the other exciting things they have. So Trish and the girls are going off this week to Africa, okay? Yeah. Tomorrow, right? So excited about that. They'll be a month or more than a month in Africa, and then they're going to try to catch up with us in Peru. So they got 2 months of wild and crazy ahead, right? Yeah, so can you speak Swahili? No? No? Do you know that the language of the country you're going to? I mean, do you know what it's even called? I'm trying to ask you a quiz question. What is it? It's a tribal language? So they only speak it in that region.
English.
Oh, good luck with that. English? Some English?
Yeah, the kids that are in the orphanage are taught English.
Taught English. Good. Well, let's pray real quick for them, okay? And Justin's going to come back and he's trying to get all his high school seniors gathered up here, and they're out and about and running around. But let's pray for Trish and the girls real fast. Is that all right? Go ahead. You want to go to a realm you've never been in. It's like a football huddle. Father God, I pray for these girls as they go out to do your will. Lead them by your Spirit, O God.
Yes.
Let them feel the unction and the anointing, yes, the power and presence of God upon them. In those hard places, Lord, give them courage.
Mm-hmm.
Let them take land, Lord. Let them take it.
Yes, God.
Give them victory, Lord, in all that they go to do.
Mm-hmm.
Let them see you. Let them have spiritual eyes. Let them conquer and let them be a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
They'll be drilling wells and all kinds of things, Lord, that they've never done before. Go with them, help them, give them wisdom.
Yes.
As they treat people medically, Lord, just Lord, let people recover. Yes. Let them even lay hands on those, God, like your word says.
Yes.
And let them recover. Let them be made well in the power of Jesus. Mm-hmm. So, Lord, in the next 2 months, we pray, God, as we send these girls out, we pray that you would do something beyond what they could ever ask or think.
Yes.
And that your power would rest upon them.
Yes.
And your wisdom would be made known to them.
Mm-hmm.
You go with them from this moment until the moment they return. Mm-hmm. In safety and in joy.
Yes.
We'll give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Very good. Yeah, sure. Wonderful.
All right, so if there's any seniors in here, I'd ask that you guys only come up here, please. Would love to just talk about you some. Dakota, that's you. Ivy, yeah. Yeah, you guys can come back up. Yeah, show you guys off to this group of people. Is that, yeah, that's all. All right, here, there you have it. Yeah, I'll stand. Stand right here. So, all right, here you go. I'll cut you. You can get up. Almost fell. That would have been bad. I'll get down here. Yeah, that would have been bad. Good thing there's a lot more out there. So, anyway, guys, this is the seniors. Some of them that are graduating from the church. Been around, been part of the church. Blessed by them. Blessed knowing them. Just want to lift you guys up. But just so that way, if people don't know you, just want to name age school and what you're doing. I'll let you go first.
I'm Olivia Morris. I am 18. I went to Urbana. I graduated last Sunday. And in the fall, I'll be attending The Ohio State University, ATI, majoring in agri-science education to become an ag teacher.
My name is Delilah Myers. I went to Graham High School, and I'm 19 years old. I will be going to Ohio University to study early childhood education.
I am Dawson Patton. I graduated from Miami East. In the fall, I will attend Ohio Christian University to get my degree in divinity and specialize in New Testament teaching and become a missionary.
I'm Natalie Woodward. I'm 18. I went to Graham High School, and I will be attending Muskingum University. I will be majoring in nursing, minoring in psychology, and also playing soccer there.
I'm Dakota Howard. I just graduated from Urbana High School, and I'll be attending Edison and studying physical therapy.
I'm Ivy Goings. I go to Graham. I'm 18, and I'm going to Clark State for nursing.
All right. So that's pretty, yeah, that's for you. it's pretty exciting just to hear what you guys are doing. I know as a church, just been blessed to get to see you guys grow and to see you guys shine in different things you've really, really enjoyed and had a passion to do. If you're wondering why Dawson and Olivia didn't get something, they got it first service. So I'm not being mean to them. If I can just share with you guys just for a moment, as you guys are in a place that's exciting, that you guys should be celebrating, rejoicing that you've passed high school, which, you know, we take it for granted, but there's kids that don't. There's kids that don't have that opportunity, and I was challenged one day thinking about that. It's like, gosh, it's pretty incredible, you know, that you guys have achieved that. So that's an exciting thing that we're proud of you for. But as you go out into many different places, do many different things, have your ups and downs, I just want to challenge you and encourage you. The Bible that we gave out this year is the Jesus Bible. It's a regular Bible, the NIV, but it has devotions. It just tries to pinpoint Jesus in every single chapter. It tries to show you just that glory, that goodness, that promise, that peace that is so important. eternity changing for each and every one of us when we seek that. And so I'm excited for that. I challenge you guys to seek, to look to that, to hold on to that. In Hebrews 12, 1, I should have it out already, but I don't. Let's see how fast my phone loads. But Hebrew 12, verse 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witness, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And so as you guys are celebrating, you're excited, you're getting ready to go off and do different things. Some of you guys are going far away for school. Some of you guys are hanging out around here. Some of you are walking into just different things in your life. Something I want to challenge you guys with is this, is in verse 2. It says, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. And what is that joy? You are that joy. Jesus endured that cross thinking of you. Thinking of your life and thinking of just the plan that he had for you from the very beginning. And so as you go out and you take those steps and you go through this life, never lose that. Never lose sight of the fact that Jesus endured the cross just for you. We gave you these Bibles. We also gave you this journal. And the verse on there says, be still and know that I'm God. And in your life, the greatest thing you can ever do is coming before God, just in that moment, in that stillness, you and him talking, seeking, and just going for it. When you do that daily, when you do that sometimes hourly, that is something that will give you so much more than you could ever even dream or imagine. So as you guys go off, we love you, we're proud of you, we're just excited and blessed that we got to be part of your guys' lives, and just excited to see where God has taken you. So I want to pray, and then you guys can go grab your seats. So, Father, just thank you so much for each and every graduate, Lord, that stands here today. Lord, as it is an exciting, amazing time in their lives. What an achievement and accomplishment to graduate high school. As they have their plans, as they set off to go to college and to work on degrees and all those things, Lord, I pray that you would just direct their paths. Lord, that you would lead them, you would guide them, God, that they would have a desire to just do your will. Be excited living in that and knowing, God, there's nothing else greater in this world they could ever achieve or accomplish other than following you. And Lord, it is an amazing thing to follow you. So I pray that that's their hearts, that's their desires. I pray that you would give them strength in days to come. Lord, that they would realize and have an understanding and knowing that's all they ever need. You'll take care of them. So, Lord, we love you. We lift them up. We're grateful. We're thankful for them, God. We ask that you bless them in an amazing way. In Jesus, let me pray. Amen. All right. You guys can clap for them.
Amen. If you'd like to stand with us. I don't even think there's any offering plates up here yet. Are there? There, there. Here they're coming.
Here they come.
Okay. Thank you.
What you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. Give me faith to trust what you say. My flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. What you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life.
I'm broken inside,
and I'm broken inside, I give you my life.
Amen. We give the Lord our lives this morning. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you and worship you. Father God, our trust and hope is in you. You are the rock and the foundation that we stand upon, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you.
nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. In Christ alone, Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, we made strong in the Savior's love. Trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the
lift up our voices, singing.
In Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in the Savior's love, through the storm.
Lord of all. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a praise this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, we need you now. We need you more than ever. I think about the seniors this morning and how they're going out into starting a new chapter of their lives, Father, and a lot of decisions are made on their own. Father, let them know that they need you and to call on you and to cry out to you, Father God. Hallelujah.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found, it's where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Song talks about
Lord, is the breath in our lungs. We're going to pour out our praise to you, Father, this morning. Because we don't know our next breath or what's going to lie tomorrow or at the end of this day. So let's give the Lord our praise right now.
Praise to you only.
Father God, we praise you this morning. Lord, we don't deserve what you've given us, Father. Forgive us, Father, for the times we don't recognize you in our lives, when things come along and we're feeling down for ourselves. God, you are our hope. You are our strength, Father God. You supply our needs, Lord. Why do we care about what tomorrow will bring, Father? You have what we need right now, right here. You are our breath, Father God. Father, we praise you. Hallelujah. You are life. The enemy is death, and we stand against the enemy today. You are life, Father God. You are light. Let us be a light to the world, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Our love.
Hallelujah.
So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath. In our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. In your breath, in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath. In our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
Whatever we face, we know that God is greater than all our problems and situations. God is before us, the creator of all things. Father, we're here to praise you today. We're here to honor you, Father God. Great are you, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you for this time of worship, Father. We thank you for this moment right now, Lord. Speak through our pastor, Lord. Give us wisdom. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Morning. Memorial Day weekend. Pour out our praise. It's your breath. Steve, you did good. You did good. You did good. I like that song. How can you not like that song? If you're a worshiper, you got to like that song right there. All right, good morning, good morning, morning. We got a bunch of people camping, a bunch of people moving around. Six to 9 million Americans went 200 miles from their house. So Dina's mom's in from Maine today, so we got an East Coaster here with us. East Coast with us, so glad you're here. Hope you feel welcome. What's your first name? Deborah. Welcome, Deborah. Glad you came to church. Dina and Tim are kind of growing on us a little bit, so... Yeah, they do, don't they? They don't. Tim came along right away. It's Dina that we've had. I'm just joking. Hey, good morning. Good to see everybody. Thanks for coming to church today. I always want to make it today like something passing by. Yay! All right, good to see you. Man, we were talking about children. We're going to have 9 verses this morning of just general teaching. And one of the children obey your parents. And about that time in the first service, a grandma was taking her kid out because the kid was acting up. And the kid fell down on the floor and grandma drug her out the back door in the first service. I said, man, that's an object lesson, isn't it? It was awesome. So we need a couple kids to be jerked out of church today in the middle of this. It was pretty good. It was really pretty funny. Of course, mom came back and said, I'm so embarrassed. I'm like, no, that was great. Anytime we talk about kids, just drag your kids out. It'd be great. Oh, it's fun. It was so much fun. Okay, we're excited. The church has purchased something. I saw it for the first time this morning. For you adults, you're not going to, unless you are men or still like kids, for the youth camp this weekend, you know, there's an obstacle course day where we basically get to torture kids back for just torturing us all year long, you know, around here. Youth pastoring, you know, you take it, you take it, you take it, and then you have this youth camp where you get them all back, you see? It's kind of turn the other cheek, and anyhow, the church bought a foam machine. For the boy in me, oh man, it produces a stream of foam like that big around. And we got a couple of hills back here behind the church, and the first obstacle on the obstacle course is they got to go up this plastic cart with all this foam on it. They'll never be able to get up that. They got to work as a team to get up this whole thing. And then I'm going to steal it from the church, take it over to Zach's house. Because Dak's got a couple wild boys, and they got like 200 feet of hill. Oh my goodness, those kids are going to be out. They're going to be in the lake. You know what I mean? The lake's like a mile down the road from you. They're going to be in the lake. They'll be going down. Anyhow, we're pretty excited to have a foam machine here at the church. You know, most pastors are thankful for this thing or that thing, you know. You know, we have a new communion thing or this or that. I know, we got a foam machine, man. We're rocking church now. You know, don't tell anybody, but I always tell Justin, I probably shouldn't, there's mothers in here, I ought to be careful. I say, Justin, if we don't have a broken bone every now and then, we're not doing this hard enough with teenagers. So, you know, I shouldn't have said that in the public. You know, we probably got that on tape, so we're going to just shut that tape down, you know. Anyhow, for teenagers, they love to live on the edge, and we love to have fun with them and half kill them and all that stuff. So, all right, glad you came to church today. I probably shouldn't have shared any of that with you. I have a 17-year-old, and I'm just telling you right now, when he heard foam machine, he's like, yeah, that's the greatest thing ever, man. You know? So, Father, thank you for a foam machine. So excited. The 45 people are going to prove this summer, and the 11 high school graduates that are in our church. And Lord, we're very excited. This season, Lord, is such an amazing season this time of year. Lord, we're thankful for our many, many blessings for good folks and a good church. Hallelujah. Thank you for a little bit of air conditioning we got in here right now, and for the good people that have gathered. And Lord, just for your presence in our time of worship today. Joe prayed over us, such amazing thing. God, we speak that good and that life over us right now, Lord. Just come and bring us life, bring us life, bring us life. Even as I preach today, just pour life into us, Lord. And accomplish what you will. The first service, Lord, I didn't see any of that object lesson coming. But Lord, you did something that woke us all up in the middle. Lord, would you just have your will in this service, I pray. Enlighten us all, Lord. Help us all. Let the preacher, Lord, be blown away that you enlightened us so much today by your word. The power and presence of your word spoken into us, Lord, we receive it today with joy. So give it to us, Lord, we pray. We thankful in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't know, man. I'm wound up this morning. Maybe just talking about a foam machine or that. Maybe it was that worship. That worship was good. A couple of my favorite songs are in there this morning, so... Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for it's right. general teaching, about 9 verses here. You know, Paul's trying to close up this book to this really good church at Ephesus in this 6th chapter, and he's just trying to give them some general instruction. We just came out of marriage teaching, husbands and wives. I don't know if we touched any of that last week in this service. We did in the other service, but Ephesians chapter 5, some real good teaching on marriage, wives and husbands. And we kind of come out of that and talk about children here for a minute. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for it's right. You know, one of the last some of the end time signs is that children will be disobedient to parents. Woo! You been in the grocery store lately? Anybody been in the grocery store lately? Lady, stand back. I'm going to beat your kid for you. What's that whole verse? You know, you spare the rod, spoil the child. That's what I'm looking for right there. Stand back. I'm going to not spoil this kid. You guys understand parenting is such a God thing. It's you get this relationship, you get it. I don't shouldn't have to. It's this love for something you created that is beyond what they can understand, and sometimes it has correction in it because that's what's best. Does everybody get that? And kids should not see that correction as ugly or mean. Kids should see that as very loving. Now they don't. In the spiritual sense, I tell you, just so you know, I'm the oldest of 3 boys. We got beat like every day, man. My parents, we had a willow tree in our front yard. Willow tree branches are the worst switches. I learned to dance when my mom was switching my ankles, man. And we got it all the time. And it was good for us. We needed it. We really did. We needed it. We really needed it. I can tell you some things we did as kids, and oh, my goodness. And my dad was a very strict, I don't know, my dad wasn't around a lot. He worked a lot. But when he was around, you did what he said. There was fear and trembling, you know what I mean? Dad came in and it wasn't what it should be. Oh my goodness, he would jerk you up in a second, you know? My dad did not negotiate at all. My mom did. Moms are known for negotiating. We had a lady in our church last week work with our kids here. And just an example of this, she's a grandma now, but she was working with the kids upstairs, and she said to a couple boys that are pretty rowdy, she said, "If you'll be good, I'll give you cookies." And they said, "We want the cookies now." She said, "No, no, no, you got to be good." So the kids kept working her a little bit, so she gave them a cookie. You know what I mean? And she said, "But you got to be good." You know, and they started acting up. She said, "I'm not going to give you a cookie." And they said, "Give us a cookie." So she kept feeding them cookies the whole time, you know, just negotiating with them. You know what I mean? Mom was a negotiator. Mom would negotiate with us, and often we could kind of push mom around a little bit, you know. But moms are also, let me tell you something, the best gift there is in this world is a mom. To this very minute, my mom's pretty sick right now, and just at the end, kind of at the end of life, and just sitting in a chair a lot, just barely able to get to the bathroom and back to a chair, and it's sad. It really is sad because my mom's been very active in life, beating us 3 kids. But we kept her young. What was I going to say? But greatest gift, that's right. The greatest gift in my life, other than Jesus dying for me, was my mother. And all you moms, just listen. There's something about you that nothing compares to you. Be encouraged today. Even though you are negotiators and get pushed around every now and then, there's nothing greater than you. Okay? And all you dads, listen. Be what you're supposed to be. That makes sense? Be what you're supposed to be. Be that solid person that doesn't react out of anger. That makes sense? Speaks wisdom into things, is very much the one, can be very much a disciplinarian, but doesn't do anything out of anger, does it out of just wisdom. Think about God and all that, how God, you know, the Bible's very clear. Those who I love, the Lord speaking, I chasten or I discipline. I stand on a stage today, listen, and God has, I bet you I failed God more than anybody in this room. And God's had to discipline me more. I'm telling you, God trying to get it right in this stubborn boy's head had to get it right. And the Lord has had to deal with me and deal with me and deal with me and deal with me. Often with men, I don't know why I'm saying this, I just feel like it's the Holy Spirit. Often with men, if we don't do right, we end up losing things. We end up losing. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for it's right. We all believe that, don't we? Parents, love, even when kids don't understand. You know? I got a boy in this room right now. I got a 17-year-old boy in this room right now. And it's not too macho to talk to a 17-year-old boy about how much you love him. You know what I mean? It's just not. But whether he knows it or not, he's won me over. He thinks when I get on him that I hate him. Because my tone isn't all that great. But the fact of the matter is, it's just what I want him to be the best he can be. The best he can be. I talk to him sometimes about, you got a football coach. Do they talk nice to you? No, they yell at you all the time. I'm your life coach, man. Football come and go. Life just keeps going. And I worked with him yesterday. I hate to tell you, I worked with him yesterday. He's 17, graduated. He's here in the room right now. He graduated 11th grade, barely, but he graduated 11th grade. I'm just kidding. But he'll be a senior next year. You know how fast that senior year passes? You know how many more he worked with me yesterday? So you know how many more days we have that we can work together? You know, those days are going away. You understand that? You have a limited amount of time, and things change very quickly. Next verse. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. First commandment. Very first commandment. Honor your father and mother. The promise is, look at this, look at the next verse. That it may be well with you, and you may live long on the earth. There's two promises here. You get that? If you honor your father and mother, I think this sounds funny, but the first verse, I always look at this, first verse is obey your parents. That's when you're in the house. And honor your father and mother when you're out of the house. That makes sense? And it says this, it will be well with you. That's a unique set of verses. How you handle your parents is also how God wants to bless. There's something about your attitude towards your parents and how you do that God blesses. It'll be well with you. And you'll live long on the earth. Probably because your parents didn't kill you. But the truth of the matter is, if you'll obey your parents and then later honor your parents, there's a promise you're going to live long. And that's an interesting, you don't see that kind of stuff often in the scripture. You know what I mean? So it's a big deal. It's a big deal. Right? Specific instruction now to a father. Next one. And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath. I always take that verse as, don't be so hard on them that they actually go the other way. For dads, there's a moment where you got to back off just a little bit. I'm a big believer. I always think of parenting as a high jump principle. I know that sounds crazy, but you know your kids well enough that you ought to set the bar at the height they can get over it. And sometimes, dad, if they set the bar too high and they can't get over it, you're provoking your children. You're telling your children you're expecting some of your kids they can't ever do, and they're going to fail in that. And when they fail you, they're going to know, and they end up going the other way. God, Father God, isn't trying to put the bar so high we can't, that makes sense, or have an expectation of us that we can't ever do. But God knows where we are, and he has an expectation of us being completely all that we're supposed to be. That makes sense? You ever think of yourself like that? Lord, thinking about yourself for just a minute. Lord, am I being what you want me to be? Am I doing what you want me to do? Have I pushed myself? Have I stretched myself? Some people in this church trying to speak to them much about stretching themselves. And I don't know how to say this to you. Can I just come right at you and you're going to get mad at me because some of you know who I'm talking to. Stretching means you start to move out of where you are and begin to do some things you've never done before. And if you've stood in worship like this all these years, and the Lord's trying to stretch you, you ought to at least do this. Now, I'm getting on a couple of people here, but the truth of the matter is, are you willing to be stretched? There are people that will be great, do great and mighty things in faith, you know what I mean? But they're willing to just, they're willing to step into the unknown. You get that whole thing? They're willing to hear God and step. And then there are people that are so reserved that they may never walk in what God has for them because they've patterned themselves to be boxed in. You catching that? And God, when God comes along, I don't know how you get this whole thing, but when God comes along, all of a sudden he begins to say, you don't forget all that other stuff. He starts to say, follow me, follow me. And the fishermen threw their nets down, and they followed. But later, Jesus says to some, follow me. And he's, no, I just got married. I can't. No, I got this. The crazy one is, I just got these oxen. I just got these oxes. I think it was Elijah later. Elijah comes by, and Elijah kills his oxen, cuts them up, sacrifices them. He's just like, I don't need these oxen. If the Lord's called me, psst, I don't need this oxen. Listen to me. God has these wonderful, amazing things for your life. Learn how to hear God and follow. It's really not that hard to follow God. It's really not if we'll genuinely follow. But it's those, how do I say this to you? It's those patterns or these things that you've grown up with that just hold you back from being all you're supposed to be. And parenting is supposed to develop all that. That makes you develop that. And certainly God is trying to develop your potential. God's trying to really move you into. And fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. Fathers, train them. You know, moms are usually the trainers in the family, you know. But this is a specific verse to fathers saying, do some training. Teach them about the Lord. Teach them to love the Lord. The very first thing I have in some writing I've done, 26 things my father should have taught me, the very first thing that fathers need to teach their kids is, God loves you, love him back. The greatest thing I could ever tell you, of all the great things I could ever tell you, especially to teenagers here, is God genuinely loves you. All he wants back from you is for you to love him back. Just love him back. Next verse. Bondservants, be obedient to those who are masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in sincerity of heart as to Christ. Like I said, there's some general teaching here in this modern day. Employees, do the best job you can do for your employer. I'd love to talk about this for a minute. As Christians in the workplace, God has you there for a reason. Does everybody get that or understand that? I don't care if you're there 5 minutes, 5 days, 5 years, 25, it don't matter. God puts you in a place for a reason. Here's what you shouldn't do. Get caught up in the drama of the place you work. God trying to make you a light in that dark place, trying to make you a light there. You get that whole thing? And the enemy understands that. And the enemy is trying to pull you in to the negativity that's around you. So much of what you as a Christian need is something from God to stand apart from the world, you know? You can't, if you're not getting something from God to be strong, if you're not getting something from God to be a light, if you're not excited spiritually, wound up on the inside, you get to work and you end up getting caught up in work. You get caught up in the flesh, the drama that's at work. Negativity brings negativity. Does that make sense? And a Christian can get caught up in all that. If God isn't live in them, if God isn't, and often our eyes get on the wrong things. And we miss these opportunities at work to be this beacon of light because we get caught up in bondservants or employees. Be obedient to those who are your masters. Do a good job. Employees ought to be, Christian employees ought to be the best employees. Right? I'm a big believer that everybody knows who you are. If you're working around somebody, they know you. They know what your deal is. They know what you tend to do, how you tend to talk, what you tend to... You can be very much a light in the place you work. That makes sense? I'm in this position, okay, where I have a job. That makes sense? I get this job. And I come to work, and I better not be carnal, and you know, and I better not be fleshly. I better have some, woo, I better be wound up. This job, I deal with a lot of hard circumstances. I deal with a lot of people's problems. I deal with sometimes complaining, you know what I mean? It's no different than any other job. You get a complicated sort of things, and there's things you're trying to do, and there's roadblocks in the way, and this, you know what I mean, and la, 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 you know. It's your breath in my lungs, so I pour out a praise. I pour out a praise. Listen, I can get caught up in all the stuff. Don't get caught up in the stuff. Live above. Everybody hear me? Often, when the pressure's on the most, you're missing the greatest opportunity. The enemy's a master at distraction. You ever watch a magic act? Often a magic act is just distracting you from what they're really doing. That makes sense? Looky here while I do something over here. That makes sense? Looky here, I got your watch. You didn't get that, did you? Look right here. Sometimes politicians do the same thing. Hey, look over here. Well, they're doing this over here. And that's what the devil does all the time. He loves to do it in your workplace because the devil loves people to just operate in their flesh. According to your flesh. With fear and trembling. Look at that. Look how serious you ought to take. You ought to take this opportunity you have with your employer. That makes sense? With fear and trembling, you ought to be, the other verse is, with fear and trembling, work out your salvation, right? Fear and trembling, work this thing out. I mean, be very careful. Be very, very careful how you handle your employer because it's important. It's in the, with fear and trembling. That, you get that whole thing? How serious God takes that. Next verse. Not as I please, or the men, Not with eye service as men pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. Not trying to be a man pleaser, but trying to do what's right, what the will of God is from your heart, sincerely trying to do. I was in a position, really almost a general manager in a business for a while, and at one point I had 70 women working for me. That was training for church, man. I'm just telling you. That was training for church. Oh, my goodness. And let me just tell you this. I knew every one of them. I knew their names. I knew their work ethic. I knew what their issues were. I knew if they were troublemakers. I knew if they were cussers. I knew if they were smokers. I knew the whole thing. And we get these big government contracts, okay? And we bring these people in. A lot of times they were building circuit boards for me, just lots and lots of wiring and circuit boards and things like that. And when those contracts, those government contracts would go away, there was this perfect opportunity then to cut people. And I just want you to know something. I knew who the real workers was. I knew who the positive people were. It was really easy. It was just so easy for me to realize who I'm keeping and who I'm not. You might say, man, you're a cutthroat. That's just how that business worked. But trying to please God with your heart at work. Next set of verses, go. Like I said, there's nine of these here, just to help us. With goodwill, doing service, as to the Lord and not to men. You're working for who? As a Christian, you're just working for the Lord. Lord, I'm doing this for you. Lord, I'm doing this for you. I'm doing this for you, Lord, I'm doing this for you. In those hard places, on those hard days, Lord, I'm doing this for you. I don't want to get caught in the yuck. I don't want to get caught in negativity. I want to live beyond. Lord, you live in me. Lord, live in me. Lord, shine. There's an old Newsboy song. You got that? Shine. Dun, 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 dun. You'll find that quick. Making wish that they were not on the outside looking bored. You know that song? Shine. Let it shine before all men. Let them see good works and then let them glorify the Lord. You know? I'm nothing to look at. I know I'm not. But I know when I get on this stage, I got to give you my best. That makes sense? I got to do something that, you know, I got to entertain a little bit. I got to try to hear God's Spirit playing. It's okay. Yeah, it just got to be on. You got to be on. You got to be a God man. You got to be a God man. You got to live in that. You got to live in that. You got to live in that. Hit it, boss. Here it is. I didn't do this the first service. You gotta shine! Listen, Newsboys, that's good stuff right there. I didn't do that in the first service at all. But listen to who you are. Do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? I don't think you know who you are. Do you know who you are? You're the light of the world. You're a city sitting on a hill. You're made to shine. Not to be some dud in a workplace. Right? And I know it's hard, and I know you're under pressure, right? That's why, listen, often God will require you to get something from Him that you can't manufacture on your own to be what you're supposed to be. You all get that? Whatever you do, don't get caught in the mully grubs. Get caught in the complaint. Get caught in the negativity. Get caught. I got to be careful. Them people, listen, need the light so bad. L-O-L. L-O-S-T. They're lost. Lost. And some of them are prideful and arrogant and mean, cocky. They don't care about being anything you care about being. They can come to work late. They can have bad attitudes. They can grumble, complain. They sow negativity. You got the course? You turned it off, didn't you? Just give me the shine part. Have a shake run onto the face to a certain side. Shine, make them wonder what you got. Make them wish that they were not on the outside looking for. Shine, let it shine before all men. Let them see good works in men. Let them glorify the Lord. Right? Change your world. Don't let the world change you. Change your world. Get something from God. Get some juice. Get some charge. Get some positivity. You know, hook up to something that gives you some energy. It ain't coffee I'm talking about. Espresso is not that. You hear me? Do you know who you are? Do you really know who you are? Do you really know who you are? I am. I wish I could just come up with this big old statement. I am one of God's favorite kids. You know what I mean? And I am an overcomer. And I plan on someday what that says about the overcomer, that I'll get a sit on the throne with my God. Does that make sense? I have a feeling that someday I know I'm going to overcome this trial and that trial. Hey, I just start seeing stuff as things that I'm just going to overcome them. You know what I mean? Bar gets higher. I'll just dive into God more. Does that make sense? God will help me. God will help. He's always been able to help me get over my next hurdle. He's always helped me with my next problem. He's always helped me in my next issue, you know. I'll just go get some more from Him. I'll be more loaded and prepared and ready to rumble than I was before. Next one. You get some people coming to church and don't even know who they are. You get some people coming to church, they're big old whiner, complainer, gripers at church. I only put up with that so long. You know what I mean? Whoa, 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 whoa. Are you not a child of God? What are you doing? Acts chapter 17. God knows the number of your days and the boundaries of your dwelling. That makes sense? God knows exactly where you are. In Wednesday night, as we studied David, David makes that sin with Bathsheba, and God, in scolding him, says to him, I brought you from the shepherd's field, and I brought you into this palace, you know what I mean? And I've been good to you, and I've delivered you from all your enemies, and if you would have needed more, I would have given it to you. And for so many of you, you complain because you don't have the next thing. Well, listen, God brought you so far. If you need more, He'd give it to you. Does that make sense? Just be content where you are. Learn to love God where you are. Learn to be a light where you are. How about self-reflection, self-investigation? You know what I mean? End of this chapter, I think it says, be imitators of God again. He says it back, I think, in the first verses of chapter 5, and he says it at the end of this day. So he does this whole big long line of teaching here. He starts with be imitators of God, and we're not going to get there today. But at the end, he said, be imitators of God again. Next verse, and I won't even get through these 9 verses. And you, masters, do the same thing to them, giving up threatening. Knowing that your own master also is in heaven and there is no partiality with him. Then you people who have authority over people, treat people right. Because God treats you right. God is slow to anger and quick in love, right? God is slow in anger, quick in love. What should a boss be? Slow to get angry? Quick to love. Now we get into some more specific teaching, and I got like 4 minutes. Go. The best part's right here. Finally, brother, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. What do I taught you to do? I guess I didn't teach you that. We used to read that verse all the time and go, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. There you go. That's pretty good. Don't be a victim. Don't be a whiner. Don't be a, I don't know what I'm going to do. Life's so bad. Some people go as far as, I don't even want to live. You're missing something. Something is very broken. The scripture's saying be strong in the Lord. Be bold in the Lord. I know people have specific giftings. Listen to me. And when they walk into a place, they know who they are and they know what they're supposed to do. When they walk into a place, all of a sudden, they don't mess around too long. They know what it is they got to get after, right? I know people are talented in different things. When they come, they troubleshoot something, they go right after what they're supposed to, you know what I mean? They're powerful, they're strong. They know what they're doing. They're confident, you know? And that's what this verse is saying. Be strong in the Lord. And listen, you know who you are, now be it. Come up here to preach. Well, you know, I don't really feel like preaching today. For me, in the last year or so, I've had so much knee pain, different things happening. There's a whole bunch of days I get up, I don't feel like. But I like to work anyhow. For years, I've been telling my body what to do. My brain's been telling my body what to do because my body don't want to do it. Does that make sense? And when it, listen, stand on this stage, sometimes I feel like, I got nothing to give him, Lord. I hurt so much. But Lord, you're bigger than that. Lord, you're bigger than that. Lord, you're bigger than that. I got to be strong in you, Lord. I got to be strong in you. Man, I get on the stage. I'm telling you, I very rarely leave this stage where I ain't giving you every single dose of everything I got. I wish I had more time sometimes. I'm about out of time now. But be strong in the Lord. Come with confidence. Be strong in the Lord. Pray boldly. Lord, you did it. You're the author of the whole earth, Lord. Come. Jesus, come right now and heal. Lord, come right now and deliver. Lord, come right now and save. God, I'm thinking, you know, that's what God's in the front. God isn't just saving me from my sins. God, try to save me every day. Gotta hurry. Go. So much good stuff in here. Put on the whole armor of God. What's it mean when you say put on the whole armor of God? You gotta do something. Is God afraid of the devil? No. You got to put on God. You got to put on something to get through this world. That you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That's the old King James wiles, the strategies of the devil. The devil has strategy. I always think of Wile E. Coyote, how he always escaped from the plot, you know? Trying to get him. No, he's on escape. You know, the devil has strategies against you. He'll use your weaknesses against you every single time. He's got you figured out. He'll come at you in a way to discourage you and beat you. He'll get you caught. He'll get you speaking. So I hear people speaking exactly what the strategy of the devil is, you know. It just drives me crazy how God was trying to take these children, his children, to a new promised land. And all they did all the way there was complain. I'm taking the land of milk and honey. Yeah, but it's hot out here. And we got no water. We got no honey. Devil has a strategy. If you know what your weakness is, you better watch it. You hear me? I never can think of them when I say, but there's three roots to sin, right? There's pride. There's the eye of lust, the lust of the eye. And what's the third one? What? Pride, lust of your eye, and there's something of your flesh. Anyhow, the enemy will use those three roots to get you off. Next we'll go. I'm sorry I brought something up. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood, against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness in this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Your problem isn't a person. Let me tell you how this works. People that are not spiritual, the enemy uses them all the time to attack spiritual. You get that? Everybody get that? Your fight is not that person. They just don't have any clue what they're doing. Jesus hung on a cross. What did he say? Forgive them. Hear me. They don't know what they're doing. The same thing's happening to you when people are doing to you what they do. It's a spiritual thing. They don't know what they're doing. The enemy just uses their flesh nature all the time to whip up on the Christian. That's what happens. You don't wrestle against them. That's why so much of what you're wrestling with, you have to deal with spiritually. You have to get something from God. I'll say this again. My time's going to... But everything's hard until you mature above it. And once you've matured above it, all of a sudden this stuff that seems so hard... When I was a little kid, I was so afraid to put my hands in an electrical box. That guy right there works on power lines all the time, man. When you first started, it's like, you know, tiptoeing scared to death, right? Right? Until you realized what you were doing. And when you realize that, you don't have that fear anymore, do you? You don't. I mean, I know what I'm doing. I got to be careful. I know this could kill me. But so often, what you're dealing with, God just trying to mature you beyond it. When you get mature enough, that thing that you're dealing with right now isn't going to be that tough at all. Oh, my time's up. Gosh, I want to preach. That you may be able to, I'll end right here. That take up therefore the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. You know what that says? There's going to be an evil day. There's going to be days where it's on, man. It's on, it's on. What this scripture is saying is you stand in that day. Don't retreat. Don't quit. Everybody hear me? Big mistake that people make often is they quit. In the hard points, they quit. No, no, no. You as a Christian, on those really hard days, you stand. It's like the house built on a rock. The storms still come. At the end of the storm, the house stands. You didn't give up nothing. What the enemy wants you to do is back up, go in reverse, or quit. What the scripture is telling us is when you're in that spiritual hard place, hey, stand. Don't give up nothing. I got to let you go. Father, thanks for time together today. Memorial Day weekend. Bless their travels. Bless their picnics. Lord, be very near. Lord, give us eyes to see spiritual things in our families, in these relationships, in the people we're talking to. Lord, just open us up wide open, Lord, to hear your voice. Use us, use us. Let us shine. Forever give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for coming, everybody. See you again real soon.